I'm very very pleased and very honored and also very excited to introduce Ron Berger to you. You've met him already, in a sense, through his essay, Culture of Quality, which you've all read. I encourage you to also get his book, An Ethic of Excellence. It's excellent, and it's very ethical. Ron, as you know from A Culture of Quality, thinks a lot about the culture of classrooms and schools and what supports quality, the doing of quality work. And so on that level, these both of the publications really address the issues about culture that we've been talking about in class recently. Here are the things that I want to say about Ron. He's an educator of children and adults. He works in, has worked and works extensively in very traditional environments, classrooms and schools, but also going outside of those into all kinds of other environments and realms, like underground and overground and things like that. True?
True.
He's an advocate of policies and practices he believes in, and he fights very hard against policies and practices he doesn't believe in. I wanted to make one point about Ron, because and his work, before he speaks, because I want you to kind of hold this in your head. You know that we've talked last term about my interest in all of you doing really in your careers as artists, art teachers, art educators, however you define yourselves, that I want you to do really excellent work. And I want you also to think about yourselves as innovators. And I think that I shared with you this thought that Vito Perone, who's on the faculty but used to teach here, had about innovative educational practices. And I don't know, Ron, whether you know this sort of thing that Vito has said about innovative educational practices. I'm going to come over here so I can talk to you, too. Vito argued that to really make educational innovations happen, you have to not only teach brilliantly, but then you have to write about your teaching brilliantly, or somehow make it available to other people outside the walls of your classroom so that they can interact with it. And I think that Ron is an educational innovator. He's a brilliant teacher, but he's also written about his work in really profound ways, beautiful ways, and also shares his work kind of endlessly and tirelessly with as many people as will come into a room and talk about it with him. And it's really kind of from one person to 3,000 people, whoever wants to come together and start looking at some student work and talking about teaching and learning, is Ron's ready for the conversation. So I think that Ron's work is really not just wonderful and brilliant educational work, but truly innovative. And I think we're very lucky to have him with us today. I said tirelessly and endlessly. It turns out if I study Ron as an innovator, one of the things that I learn is that it's good to have enormous stamina. And he does. And the thing that I conclude from that is that it's really probably good to be able to run marathons on a regular basis, which he also does. So I don't know where you get your stamina, Ron, but it's really nice to have you here. So, okay. Do you need anything? Oh, you need to know how to turn it on? Completely wrong.
Can you hear me okay?
Okay.
Okay. Does the mic think we're working? No.
No, it should be working. I would move it up your tie.
Okay. Is that better? Give me a wave if you can't hear me, then. Okay. All right. I'm so pleased that there's names in front of it. Great idea. I was going to write down all your names, but I don't have to. But what I'd love to do is, and then pardon me for taking a moment for this, but I'd like to ask each of you to share with me just quickly where you are in your trajectory. Are you a photographer who's now deciding to teach? Are you a dancer? Or are you somebody who's coming from education toward the arts? Where are you? Where do you hope to be heading this year? So, Lauren, can we start with you?
From the arts and headed toward education. Mm-hmm. I taught theater and I'm hoping to teach English with theater in a school.
Great. Okay. Steve, we'll skip you. He's not going anywhere with us. Laura.
I'm Laura and I am was a music educator and now I'm moving towards the arts in education in general, focusing in on elementary level.
Okay, great. Judy?
I run a circus school, and I want to apply here to be better at what I'm doing.
What is your circus school?
What? Where?
Yeah, or what is it? What's the name of it?
It's Providence Circus School.
Okay. If I had more time, well, I will later, I will. Victor, should we jump up to you?
I'm a visual artist.
Tony?
I'm a visual artist at theater and working on visual literacy.
Great. And would you hope to be teaching?
Yes, hope to be teaching.
At what level?
Junior high school.
Great. Aviva? What grade are you working with?
I will probably be
okay.
I was a theater major turned education major, and I hope to be teaching in high school.
I'll be doing children out here too.
Thank you.
I'm Monica. I am a singer and teacher, and would like to open a multidisciplinary integrated arts center.
Wow.
So that I can manage that to be successful and self-sustaining. I will be getting an MBA.
Yes. Thank you. My name is Christy, and my background is in curriculum development. I'm a writer and a cook, and I don't really know what I want to do. Something that's really
okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm Jeff. I'm a children's book illustrator, and I've been working as an educator at art museums.
But also, I'm like enthusiastic about working in nonprofit to kind of deal with the poverty and inequity issues in Mexico, because I'm from there. So, who will I help first? The people in the cities, the people in the rural areas, or is there a way to help them both? And how they are going to help me do that?
Great.
Journalism, and I'm hoping to do some sort of research, hopefully music learning research or educational outreach for our music organization.
Thank you. Okay. Where do you teach, Laura?
New Orleans. Yeah, one of those.
Okay. Nicole. Right?
I'm Margaret, and I'm interested in how art is used as a tool for political and social justice. What's your
tell us more.
Don't cheat. I am a photography teacher. I've taught photography for
Okay. Thank you. Thanks for indulging me. It was so great to hear what you're all doing, and it makes me want to ask a lot of questions of a lot of you. I just realized that there's a flaw for me in this name in front of you, which is that usually when I do this, I imprint faces and names really carefully, and this is too easy, having your names. No, don't do it now, because I haven't imprinted it. So I want to apologize ahead of time that if you happen to be staying for the reception, you probably will have to reintroduce your name to me, even though I will probably remember what you do. Because this takes away my need to imprint names, which is, I realized I'm trying to do it, but I can't because the name just overrides it for me. I'm Ron. I grew up outside of New York City from a family of scientists. I entered college as a science major, much to my father's tremendous distress. I left it and became an art major. Then was enmeshed in the art world, and this was way back when things were very political, and I was very involved in politics, and found the art world at that time felt too indulgent and self-indulgent to me, so I dramatically quit my major in arts and decided that education was the right political place to go. And I was very naive and foolish sort of entry into all traditional schools were bad, and I joined what was called the free school movement back then. And ended up being worse than an artist in my father's eyes, which was an elementary school teacher. I have taught public school for 28 years, and almost all of that time I have been living and teaching in a tiny town in western Massachusetts where there's nothing but a church, a bar, and a school. There are no stores, no traffic lights, and most of the roads are not paved. And I've taught every kid who've lived in that town for the last 28 years. I did take some breaks from that, and one of my breaks was to work with Steve Seidel in 1989 here in the master's program. And I have left the classroom for the moment as of this past June. And I'm working with urban schools around the country around looking at student work particularly. I work for a nonprofit school improvement organization called Expeditionary Learning Outward Bound. It's a branch of the Outward Bound Wilderness Organization. My passion in life is student work. And what's interesting to me is that although I left and terribly disappointed my family of scientists, one of my closest friends as an adult is a passionate scientist, was a passionate scientist, he's no longer alive. And the work I do looking at student work is very much like the science that excited me as a kid. There's so much discovery involved. And I'm in this very fortunate situation right now where I'm working in schools all over the country and getting to look closely at student work. And I have so much student work, I hardly have room in my house for it. And it was hard just to walk from Longfellow to Larson with just the work that I needed to bring across the street with me today. I have a disposition toward helping kids get good at work, which is not always popular in the art world. In fact, the first time I think I really brought it out fully was under the invitation of Steve and Howard Gardner at a Project Zero meeting in 1989. And it was all people could do not to throw things at me, I think, when I first started explaining it. Let me tell you why. I think in this country, we really have a fear of showing kids models of work because we're really worried that they will copy them and that will stifle their creativity. And nobody is stronger in that feeling than artists. It's not true of artists in other parts of the world, but it's very true of artists in this country. The way that I am excited about building excellence in kids' work is by showing them great work and getting them excited to emulate it. And it does run the risk of having them copy it. And in fact, I not only run that risk, I encourage them to copy it. Because I think the way we become good artists, whether it's writers or dancers or musicians, is listening to great music and watching great dancers and looking at great art and trying to copy it in our own way until we find some of our own voice in that. And I think that we don't allow kids to do that because we're afraid they'll copy. I have a very different approach, which is I spend my life collecting great student work, and when kids are going to start something, I say, this is what great work looks like. Here's five different models of it from kids your age. Let's look at what makes it great. And what I find is that the quality of stuff that comes out is incredibly greater than if I left them no vision of what we're looking for. Do they copy some of the direct things and clone some of the work? Absolutely. And that's why many people at Project Zero were heckling me at first. They said, this looks like clone work to me. But not much more than when I tried to write like Ernest Hemingway or Willa Cather, or all the people I copied when I was growing up. At first I copied, and then I started to find my own way with that. So what I'm trying to do is find beautiful student work, powerful student work, whether it's math or art or writing, and bring it to students and get involved in a critique together where we're naming what makes it good. And I have been playing with critique protocols for 28 years, and this is the most important thing I learned. If we don't name it, the kids don't take it away with them. It's not just looking at the work, it's naming the specific things that make it work so that kids can think there are five things that made Terry's piece work. Or, the reason I love Maura's painting is this, this, and this. Then they can take those strategies or those techniques with them. And if we don't name them, they just evaporate for kids. So right now, I spend my time going into high school classrooms or kindergartens and looking at work with kids, and we name things. And it's so exciting to come up with the names for those things that make things work. And then I come back a week later, and the kids have incorporated everything, not all of them always, but they've incorporated some of those things they've named. What I'd like to do today is sort of show work, talk about work. And it's fine to raise your hand and argue or disagree or ask questions right along the way. I don't need to wait for questions in that. Let me give a very specific example, since I hate to just talk without work. If my students, and I taught fifth and sixth grade students for most of that time. I also taught kindergarten, I taught college, I taught middle school a little bit, but most of that time I was working with 11, 12-year-old kids. They're doing a biography project, and one of the aspects of that project is to do a portrait of a famous person that they're studying. We could decide to create a rubric of what makes a good portrait. I could even involve the kids in making a rubric. And I could write those words down, and kids would then start their work. And I think the rubric would help a little bit, but not much. Because what they wouldn't have is a vision of what a good portrait looks like. If I say, okay, we're doing a biography project, you probably saw some of those up last year when kids did that. Let's look at some together. And then I take out a portrait of one of the students from last year. And the kids look at it, and then they think, oh, that's what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be big and bold and powerful and involving. It's supposed to have some life in it. And they have this vision. That's what we're aiming for. This one model is so much more important to them than all the rubrics I could create. And then I take out a second model and a third model and a fourth model, and we put a gallery of stuff up. Now, how do I have this beautiful work? Because it's not original. Because it's three color Xeroxes pasted together. Because I've spent hundreds of dollars color Xeroxing every piece of work I like for the last 20 years. So I have color Xeroxes of everything, or regular Xeroxes, or videotapes of everything that I can get. Whenever I visit schools, I go to the copier, then I go at night to color copy work, and I take things off the hallways, I take them out of classrooms, I borrow them and I return them, so I have more and more models of work. we talk about what makes a powerful portrait, and then the kids do powerful portraits after looking at five or six of these and analyzing them. And then people visit the classroom and say, kids didn't do these. These are much too good. The art teacher must have helped them. And I say, our art teacher comes once a week for 40 minutes. This is not an art teacher project. This is kids' work. Now that I get to work with all different ages, I'd like to tell a story of a kindergarten class in Boise, Idaho. And one of their projects is they produce note cards of birds. And they sell these note cards to raise money for bird habitats. And on the front of the note card is a picture of the bird, and on the back is a description of the bird written by the kindergartner, but keyboarded by their fifth grade buddy. Now, since it's hard to see that, let me show these on overhead. And, okay, and probably we're going to have to dim lights just for this part. Okay, so these are kindergarten drawings. They're not adult drawings. They look like kindergarten drawings, but they have some real artistic pizzazz to them. And when I take these around the country, a lot of teachers say, no way those were done by kindergartners. My kindergartners don't draw like that. Here's the back of that card. What makes this work strong is critique. And here's where this is going to get a little more controversial as you see how carefully this is shaped. Here's a final product of a kindergarten drawing for a note card. And here's four previous drafts. Now, what I want you to notice here is on draft two, do you notice that post-it up there? Well, Leo has received some critique from his classmates in a structured critique protocol, but he can't write down the notes because he doesn't write yet. So he takes his notes with symbols of which things he has to work on. And then you can see he's made those changes into draft three and then into draft four. So it's an entire symbol rather than written-based system. Now, the first grade in the same school wanted to do butterfly note cards. And they asked me if I would work with them on helping lead critique sessions. So let's tell the story of Austin. Austin's a first grader. They each chose a butterfly that was a local butterfly to do a note card. This is the butterfly that Austin chose. It's a tiger swallowtail. Some of you might know it. There's an eastern and western version of the tiger swallowtail, and they look pretty similar. It's a yellow, large butterfly, larger than a monarch. So this is Austin's butterfly. He actually got to go to a butterfly center, one of those places where you walk into a hothouse and get to be with the butterflies. And he got to see one and actually take a digital photograph of one and be around it. And after experiencing really being with a butterfly, which is what all artists would say, that's how you really draw, you have to see the living thing, here's Austin's first draft. Now, for those of us who believe in the purity of untouched kids' artwork, you'd say, well, that's what he does. This is his view of a butterfly. Let's just let him be. Let's celebrate what it is. That's not my philosophy. Because Austin wasn't pleased with it. To us, it may seem like a cute example of kids' art. To Austin, all he could say is, it doesn't look that much like that. And so we ran a structure critique session. And what we asked the kids is, what's different about the photograph of Austin's butterfly and the drawing of Austin's butterfly? And let's name it for him, because he's frustrated. Can anybody name for me some specific thing you'd say to him? Nicole? Okay. So in this class, we could actually write because they were first graders and not kindergartners. But some of the kids still use symbols because they'd come from the kindergarten where we'd been using symbols. But Austin got that same critique, that there was a pointier, more angular look to the wings. Here's his second draft. And he's a lot more pleased with it. The critique he got was the same as Nicole's critique, was that it needed to be more angular, and he had forgotten to add the swallowtails, which is what the swallowtail butterfly is labeled for, is these swallowtails. So now he's pretty excited. But he still knows that it doesn't look quite like this. He asks for more critique, and I'm running the critique session. And one of the students says, Austin, you know we learned that butterflies have an upper and lower wing. And your butterfly only has two wings, not an upper and lower wing. So he goes back and adds an upper and lower wing now. But it's not necessarily an improvement. What would you say to him? This is where he's trying to get to. Okay, he's gone back to rounding, which is that iconic thing. It's not what he's seeing, it's the icon of butterfly in his head, is that roundy, roundy thing. It's exactly what he was told by a girl in the class. So then he decided, could he retain the double wing, but get the angle back? Okay? So he's excited now, because it's really starting to look more like it. Now, we split the entire project of doing the butterfly into two sections. One is shape, and one is pattern. Class has now decided, along with Austin, that he's got the shape figured out. But now he needs to think about pattern. So they discuss pattern with him, and this is his next draft. At this point, he's really pleased with it, and he decides it's time to color. Now, this is what ended up being on the cover of the note card. And now when I carry around the note cards, first grade teachers say to me, that's not first grade work. That kid had the work done by another kid or by a teacher. That's not his own work. That's why I'm saving every draft. And I even have a videotape of the very critique where this all happened on DVD in case someone doesn't believe that this is the evolution. Now, there are people, I have to say, and it often comes from an art community, of people who say all you're doing is forcing the kid to fit into your vision of what's right. Because in truth, for little kids, this is what a butterfly is. And I have to say, I'm not down on kids' butterflies and the icon of a kid's butterfly. But we have to understand that that's our agenda, not their agenda. And that Austin wanted to make something that looked like a tiger swallowtail. And he was so pleased as a little kid, as a six-year-old, to make something that everyone was just totally blown away by, that really looked like a tiger swallowtail.
I'm wondering about kids who may be satisfied, maybe don't want to
work or not,
and say, no, this is what I want to look like, I want to. I'm thinking of my niece.
Okay. This is not a glib answer. I've never had that situation. Never. And I've been doing this for 25 years, because when you build a classroom culture where you start a project by showing five drafts of a piece of work, the kids know that this is a multi-draft process. That's what this is all about. Everything I save that's important, I save the previous draft, so kids understand this is not a rush. The drafting is part of the process. It's different. Doesn't work with my grandkids, because I'm not in that culture at school with them when I'm at home, and they're just in a rush, and that's not the point. But if you build a classroom culture or an after-school culture or a group culture where this is how you're doing things, everything is different.
So, Laura. It is important that the critique comes from other students and not the teacher. That's the...
I would say both. When I facilitate critique sessions, they are lessons. And as much as possible, I try to get things out of the students. But I am very much an active participant. I don't hold back at all. And I dive right in and use the critique to build the lessons around being a good writer or a good mathematician or wherever. Tony. Right.
In some ways, it's both. I mean, it's both things.
Yeah.
And I wanted to know what you think the advantage is of pushing it. What are the kids getting better at or more out of doing that problem?
So the question is sort of what are they getting from that in the broader sense? What's amazing, from my experience, is that these... Oh, that's. I'm going to show one more thing on this. The students who've gone through this process never draw or look different, the same at what they're doing. Once they've gone through this process, they look very differently at things. If you ask these kids to draw butterflies now, it's not iconic anymore. They're looking at wind shake, they're looking at pattern, they're looking at overall shape. They've really built their skill around that. And whatever the skill is you're wanting to build, whether it's illustration skill or writing skill or math skill, the skill comes with naming it, with understanding it and seeing better.
Do you think that they develop the skill of self-critique if they're not in a classroom setting or they're doing individual work and they don't have their peers to rely on, that they could then say, okay, I did my first draft, now what do I have to look at to make it better?
Not only do they have that skill, but you'd be amazed at how young the kids are that can do that. So I got some very nice feedback for schools in Springfield, Massachusetts that I was working with, because district personnel walked through. And they were checking up on classrooms. And they happened to enter a first grade classroom where we had done a critique the previous day. And when they stopped to talk to kids, all the kids in class were critiquing their own writing for these district personnel, and they were only six-year-old kids. But they were critiquing it voluntarily, talking about the critique session we ran and what kind of revisions they were doing in their work right now. I think kids pick up that language very quickly. Let me hold questions for a sec, because I did want to show you that despite maligning rubrics, there actually were rubrics for this, which the kids helped build so that when they were doing it, this is the pattern rubric. So does it have eye spots? Does it have borders? Does it have stripes? Does it have scallops? So the kids could have a sort of a checklist of what to make sure to include. So rubrics were a part of this, but they were a part along with some good models of the work. Judy?
I want to know, how did you set up the critique sessions so that the critique person doesn't experience it as a put down?
And then for light, Steve, is that here? I'm sorry. I don't think there's one way to do critique. But I can talk about the derivation of my own critique work. When I was an art student, a visual art student, there was critique all the time. Many of you have gone through that process. Sometimes it's a little heartless. I've worked with critique rules over the years with my students, and I've, at the moment, settled into three primary rules. You need to be kind, you need to be specific, and you need to be helpful. when I say kind, that's very easy for first graders to do. But it's not easy for seventh graders to do. And the way seventh graders are unkind is they'll say, Steve, that's really nice. And then they'll roll their eyes. Or they'll say it genuinely, Steve, that's really nice. And then they'll roll their eyes. So the way seventh graders are cruel is through sarcasm and just gesture. But this is what's amazing. Everybody in the class knows when it's genuine and when it isn't, even the teacher. So if I come into a classroom in Washington, D.C. of seventh graders, and we're going to critique work, and I lay out the rules, and it's all going well until Josh's work is up, and Judy says, I think that's a really nice opening, Josh, and then looks away. I'll stop and say, Judy, didn't sound genuine to me. Was it a put down or was it a real compliment? I can't tell. If you didn't like it, is there a way, you know? And I will call out every kid instantly if there's something unkind. And within a few days of running critique, it's just part of what the classroom is, that this is a safe environment. And it takes incredible vigilance at first to make sure there's never anything unkind said. The second issue is it needs to be specific, because if someone says, Steve, I like your work, nobody learns anything from that. It has to be something very particular for us to learn it. If we can't name a specific, we go nowhere with it. And the last is, needs to be helpful. And I have to say, these three rules I'm using right now, I'm sure will be different in a few years. They're just the ones I'm using at the moment. And being helpful wasn't on there before because I thought if you're specific and kind, it will have to be helpful. Except that I found in experience that's not true at all. Here's how it's not true. In a first grade, someone says, Lauren, I really like the way you put windows on your house. And then the next person says, Lauren, I really like that you put windows on your house. And then the next kid says, Lauren, I really like the windows on your house. Now, it's specific and kind, but it's actually no longer helpful. And it's very prevalent with little kids. And in fact, I use the sign language term, which is, I agree with you, we're the same on that, and teach it to kids right away. So when Jeff makes a comment that we agree with, we can all do it, and then you've got your affirmation in, and you don't have to verbalize it. Older kids are unhelpful in a different way, because in every high school classroom, there's a kid who wants to talk and analyze. And they're not really, it's not really for the edification of the class, it's or for that person, for Tony's work. It's because they like to be on, have airtime. So sometimes I have to say, Terry, it's a really good point, but I'm not sure it's helpful for what we're doing for the critique right now. So being kind and specific is a start, but you also have to be trying to help the process. The other thing I would say is this. When I am critiquing Joanna's work, it's not for her edification, primarily. Because if it was just for Joanna, I would meet with her individually. If we're going to take the time, as 28 kids, to look at Stacy's drawing for 20 minutes, it's to teach about drawing. It's to teach us all. It's not just to help Stacy. And so it's a formal lesson. Although the information in that lesson comes from all the kids and me directing that, but it's a lesson. It's not an individual critique, and it's for the edification of all of us. So when I say, is that being helpful, Steve, I don't mean just helpful for Laura. I mean, are we as a group learning from your critique? And if not, I will say, Steve, can you reword it? Can you say it in a different way? What can we learn from your perception here? And when kids name things, sometimes there's just these bursts where the whole class just gets it. Let me give one specific example. This was a staggering one for me. Sixth grade class in Baltimore. The kids are struggling with writing. I come in and I ask the teacher, what would you like to work on? She said, their writing is just, it's just really rough. I said, is there any writing assignment that was compelling for them? She said, well, slave journals. They're working on fictional slave journals. This is an entirely 100% African-American class. I said, do you have examples? She said, yeah. So I took piles of them. I spent 2 or 3 hours reading through slave journals all night, came back the next day and asked this girl, Kanisha, could we use yours for a critique? And she said, I'd love it. So we set up the critique rules. I Xeroxed copies of it. And I would never do writing critique without having everyone have a copy. In fact, tonight I'm doing a presentation across the way, and between 4:30 and 6, I'm going to be making hundreds and hundreds of copies of work because I want everyone to have it in their hands. And we all looked at the piece together, and we read this piece that had terrible mechanics. The spelling, the punctuation, the grammar was all off, but it was a compelling piece of writing. And we finished it, and the kids just, they said, Kanisha, how did you do that? I mean, that was just amazing. They were just absolutely in awe of her writing ability. And yet, if we had stopped there, they would have learned nothing from it. All they would have learned is Kanisha's a good writer. So what we had to do is name what she did. And we went through this naming process. And some of the naming was really good. But I could see the kids weren't totally alive with it, but they were naming it, they were getting there. And then Deshaun raises his hand in the back row. And I said, Deshaun, he said, I finally got what I love about this piece of writing. I said, can you explain it? He said, I can explain it exactly. I got it totally figured out. She writes like a movie. I said, tell me more. He said, well, I love movies. And all the things that a director who makes a movie, she uses those same things as a writer. I said, got to be more specific. I don't like getting it yet. He said, well, she uses close-ups. Like all the rest of us just talk about people and you never get close into their face or their hands. Look at all the close-ups in this piece. I said, can you read me some close-ups? And he read these pieces of great detail about her teeth and about her eyes. And the kids are like, ooh, close-ups, man. Why didn't we use close-ups? So we wrote, write like a movie. We wrote close-ups on the board. I said, what else? He said, she uses action scenes. I said, give me an example. He said, well, when that guy bursts in, why does a journal have to be dead? Why can't it have action in it? I mean, her journal has actions. I love action movies. We wrote action scenes. I said, what else? He said, she uses flashbacks. You ever see one of those movies when people have a flashback? Well, she enters that house and then that memory hits her? That's a flashback. I wrote flashback. And he just goes on and on, naming. And the kids all said, we want to start writing like a movie right now. I mean, they were ready to go. And it was totally not from my framing. It was his frame this is how interesting. This is a middle school, six through eight school. At lunchtime, I sat down and some kids from another class came over and sat at the table and said, are you Mr. Berger? I said, yeah. They said, could you teach us how to write like a movie? So what do you mean? I said, we heard you did this lesson about how to write like a movie in that class. We want to learn how to do that. I said, you're going to have to talk to Deshaun. But it was naming it that made it powerful there. And it was that process of once the kids had that concept, then they sort of knew where to go with it. It wasn't just an abstract piece. I want to take a moment to actually do that with you, with one piece of writing. But the first thing I'm going to do, if I can get the technology here, is I'm going to try to use slides. This is great. So whoever's sitting up there now, if you just turn that on. Oh, amazing. This is so great. Okay. So let me put it in context. This is and Steve, I apologize. Steve knows this project already. This is a project which I've been in a rut with for 25 years. I like this project so much that for 25 years in a row, I've used it. Here's the project. Kids create a person who doesn't exist. It's called a character file project, and they create a file on that person. But it has to be a realistic person. It's not a fantasy person. It's not a superhero. It's not an alien. It's a real person. And in fact, it has to be so realistic that when they write their career description, they have to interview someone who has that career. When they do their financial portrait, they do their checking account and their savings account, and an accountant comes into the classroom, and they do their taxes, and they do a 1040 form for their person based on their income. They do payslips on them. When they figure out where they live, they have to research how much a house or an apartment is in that city, and they have to figure out what their rent or mortgage payments would be. When they own a car, they have to figure out whether they're leasing or buying. So the criteria for these characters are they have to be real so that an adult looks at them and thinks this is really what their life would be had they chosen that. On the other hand, despite all those constraints, they can create really different, interesting characters. This is Scott Chang. He's a paraplegic astronomer created by Joey. You can see him in the foreground in his lab coat, and you can see him in the background in a wheelchair looking at the stars. These portraits all look different, but they all went through somewhere between 5 and 15 drafts. Because the kids, we did gallery critiques, we did in-depth critiques, kids, we had visiting artists come in to look at the work, we did everything we could. We cut out hundreds of pictures from National Geographic and Vogue and Sports Illustrated, and kids looked at shading and they looked at hairstyle. So the fact that there's shadows underneath parts of that hair, this comes from looking carefully at things. Again, maybe I'm constraining their creative edge, but what I'm trying to give them is the power to make it what they want.
How long did the project take over what time?
3 months, the project, entirely. Okay. Let me show you what some of the portraits look like. So they're doing all different ages of people. This is a 16-year-old deaf high school student who's also a gymnast, Autumn Helena Washington Hahn, created by Zoe. You can see her in the foreground, and then you can see her in the background on a horse. And I'll just scroll through some of the characters. I should say, the girl who did this one was house-sitting for me as of last night when I was on vacation, and she's grown up to look exactly like that. This was my all-time favorite character, Vinnie DiCarlo, and I have to tell you, this was a controversial one since the students have to get their characters approved by the class. They put in a proposal with the name, the age, the background, the profession, the career, the life, all that. And then the class does a database, so we make sure we don't have all the same kind of character and that it's all realistic, and then the class gives an approval to everyone. Well, they didn't want to approve Vinnie DiCarlo because he's a mafia member. And one of the requirements is you have to interview somebody with that job. But Tate assured us all that he'd be able to interview a mafia member. So the kids were convinced, and we went on. So Tate used the internet wisely, and interestingly, although the internet did not end up coming up with someone who was willing to admit they were in the mafia, they're actually, brought us to the interest of the FBI, and we ended up having an FBI agent visit in our classroom who specialized in organized crime. And I sat in on the lunchtime interview of that FBI agent by Tate, and this is how it went. Tate would say, "How do you launder money?" And he would answer. "How do you set up a front business? How do you do your taxes when you're in love?" And I should say, Tate is not a criminal now. He's not in the country, but he wasn't extradited from the country right now. Other parts of this project include family tree of this person, artifacts from their lives. This is a CD that one of the characters was in a band. Kind of a punk. This character got married during the year she was created. This is her wedding announcement. She also did the photographer, the caterer, all the, you know. They did blueprints for the houses of their characters. The blueprints are done quarter inch to a foot scale, critiqued by architects. They go through many drafts. At first they look like this, just like the other work. And then they go to scale. And then they start using templates. And then they end up, you know, being a finished blueprint. Since I was in a small elementary school classroom, and I taught every subject, we did them all.
What grade was that?
This was fifth and sixth grade students together. Many of the houses were big and fancy. This is a dodecahedral home with an indoor swimming pool. Not everyone lived in a fancy home. One of the characters lived at the California Correctional Institute. One of the characters here was homeless that year. Lived in an alley. Lived in this cardboard box. Here's a piece of that cardboard box. One of the things about creating this project is that I have to use it to teach kids how to write. And the first thing they have to do is write a physical description of their character. So if I had just said, write a physical description of your character, I would get something like this. She's 5'2" and she's got blonde hair and she's kind of cute. And I'd say, can you tell me more? And they say, she wears lipstick. Can you tell me more? It's kind of pink lipstick, you know. So what I do is actually start with some models. Not necessarily models with the best work, but models to get them thinking. So if we could pass some of these around. Oh, no, I'll steal models from anywhere, from the professional world, from museums, from when we do architecture, we look at real blueprints. But there's something very provocative about work of kids because they can. It's inspiring to see kids your age who are doing work. Could I have a volunteer to read aloud Anshi Saran's physical description? Thank you. Lila. Okay, the first thing I would do with this, and you can see that it has some strengths and some weaknesses, is to look at strengths. Anything strong in this piece? Anything that this author is doing well in her first draft? Dana? Okay, so right now, and I don't have a blackboard behind me, but we're going to name the fact that Dana's point, that little, that's okay. Just time-wise, I'm seeing them, as always, cutting it close. But your point is exactly right, that little details that reveal a little about the person give you a window into them. Mm-hmm. And more of that would actually help. But the toenail polish, the fingernail, those things really matter. Anything else that she does well? Tony. Good, it's comprehensive, it's fairly complete. It wasn't just she's 5'2" and she's blonde. It's her ethnicity, her skin, her eyes, her hair, it's all these different things, which many kids wouldn't think to do. So we would go through and name, I won't do it now, but we'd name everything that she's doing well, and then we'd think about what would you suggest to her next? Would you give this girl a suggestion for her next draft? What would you say to her? Judy?
What are her moods like?
Okay, in a physical description, that actually can be there because it would show on her face. So is there something about her personality more that you can show about her moods and her sort of disposition that shows through? Good, anything else? Monica. Okay, so you might want to vary the sentence structure. And I would actually say with my students, why? Why do you have to vary the sentence structure? Because some of my students would listen and think, okay, if you're going to make me, I'll do that. But why? I mean, why do we have to? And we would actually have a discussion around why varying sentence structure matters, even. Because the kids who don't vary their sentence structure don't get that. And if we don't discuss that, then they don't even understand why it's important to vary sentence structure. It's a very good point. In the interest of time, I'm sorry, this is usually half an hour critique, and I'm going to do it in 7 minutes. Who could read the physical description of Robert Kanaskis? Nicole. What's working here?
He doesn't use words like average or normal or pretty. He goes further beyond the, or I'm assuming that's a he.
It is a he, actually, yeah.
But the author goes along, and so he's constantly revising in the piece. His eyes are blue, but not usual blue. They're lighter blue, like the sky. And then he goes on even to the mood of the eyes. They're smiling on.
Okay, so the adjectives are really specific, and unspecific adjectives like normal aren't as useful. That's something we would name. Sandra.
There's an excellent use of figures of language so the reader can get a mental picture.
Could you give an example?
Yes, well, the whole dog thing is really good, but I really like the sandpaper fingers and hands.
Okay, so, and when I'm running a critique, I'm going to, as a teacher, rename what Sandra just said for my weaker writers, who don't necessarily get that she's exactly right on about figurative language. And I'm hearing two things. Number one, he's using analogies, metaphors, the bulldog, the bear, the sandpaper. He's also using sensory language. He's also having you touch that person. And she is really far away. But this guy, you're right in his face, and you're touching his hand. So there's touch, there's sense, there's metaphor. And it's not just that there's metaphor. And I hate to rush this, but when we talk metaphor with my students, the first thing they would say if you tell them to use metaphor is, Robert's lips were as red as a rose. And they'd think, well, that's a metaphor. Why doesn't it work? And so it's not just using metaphor. It's using the right metaphor. Like, why is a rose not right for this guy? But a bulldog or a wire brush is right for this guy. And so it's not just picking metaphors. It's picking the metaphor that fits your person that they would use. Arielle.
Identify with them, and it's not as
exceptional
as Angie.
I'm going to cut this, even though I'd love to go longer on it, because I have about 2 minutes, to say, can you imagine right now, if you all had to go write a physical description, how different it would be if we hadn't done critique first? If we had just said, go home and describe your person, but we hadn't gone through this process, can you imagine how short and shallow the pieces I would get? And after doing this process, you can guess how deep some of these pieces are. And I actually have them here, though not time to look at them. It's probably stupid to try to fit in anything else, but I'm going to try to squeeze in two things in the last 2 minutes. I worked with a kindergarten in Virginia 2 weeks ago, and I went through this whole process of explaining critique to the kids in the morning. And then in the afternoon, they said, could you come back to the kindergarten? And the kids asked me. And I said, OK. And I said, what? They said, we set up a critique table. I said, can you tell me how it works? They said, every kid did a drawing and a story. And then they had to ask their kids at the critique table for 3 specific suggestions. And then they had to do a second draft. Here's first and second draft. Can you tell what the specific suggestions were? Stripes on the legs, pattern on the tail, bigger. First draft, second draft. What were the specifics? Different tail, a tawny color rather than yellow, and bigger. I've got piles of it because the kindergartners just set up their own critique table and they were so excited by it. So I don't have time to show you this, but I will show you the first minute of this. Let's see. I don't know how to call this up. Oh, this is it. So the one, when I told my, when I told my school that when I told my school that I was not coming back after 28 years, the thing that the kids were most upset about was that I wasn't going to be teaching disco. I have been running a disco class at lunchtime all winter for the last 6 years. And there's no one else willing on the faculty to teach disco. But I do have to tell you that we use the exact same techniques in teaching disco as we did with everything else. We use models. We used videotape to look at before we started. The kids all worked on their routines. They each performed their rough draft routines for the rest of the group, which they created. They got critique on their routines. They revised their routines. We went through all the same process. And even though they are a little rural white kids, they really got good at disco. And I can show you, I think, this is just all magic, all this stuff here.
I was such a fan. Kept thinking I could never stand without you by my side.
I apologize, I went over on my time, but I had to show you a little bit of disco there. Thanks so much for your time.